Very good morning, my dear students. I welcome to my fifth class on design of RCC structural elements. We are discussing about the design of columns, the compression members, and the learning outcome for the today's class is that after this class, the students will be able to understand the behavior of the column subjected to uniaxial moment and the design concepts as per IS 456 2000 provisions. In fact, in the previous four classes, we discussed about the concentrically loaded columns, that is the axially loaded columns, the various types of columns, classifications, and many examples were also discussed in the previous four classes. And today we will be discussing about the column subjected to uniaxial bending. After this class, we will be discussing about the column subjected to biaxial bending. Now, what these uniaxially loaded columns are? So, in fact, you can see here, so I have given many of the practical situations of columns subjected to uniaxial bending. Most of the practical columns, especially the columns of multi-story building and even the columns of structures like chimney, columns of silo, columns in water tanks are invariably subjected to the combination of axial load and uniaxial bending. In fact, I have shown three different situations of the structural elements subjected to uniaxial bending. In fact, the first one is the eccentrically loaded compression member. So, you can see here there is a RCC column, and to the RCC column a bracket has been connected and the load is applied at some distance from the centroid of the column, and this is what the eccentricity. So, because of this eccentricity and the load is acting significantly away from the longitudinal centroidal axis of the column, so this column is invariably subjected to axial load and bending. So, whenever you have an axial eccentric load something like this, so this eccentric load can be transferred onto the longitudinal centroidal axis of the column, provided along with this load, the moment associated with this axial load is also transferred. So, in that case, the axial load applied at some distance, which is the eccentric load, means the same load acting through the longitudinal axis as an axial load along with the moment contributed by that load. So, this is one situation where the column is subjected to uniaxial bending. In fact, we have two other cases. The second one is especially the joint members in a rigid braced frames are subjected to this combination of axial load and moment, and also the sway moments in unbraced frames. So, that is also subjected to axial load and uniaxial bending. So, in fact, you can see here, so I have a portal frame. So, the base of the portal frame is fixed and this is braced in the sense, so there is a member connecting the bottom of one column and the top of this column. So, in such a situation, so this particular frame is not subjected to sway, and once some load is applied onto the frame, so this is what the bending profile of the frame you are going to get. Now, take one particular column and this is how the column really bends. So, definitely at the top and at the bottom we have the end moments. So, this is one situation of the column subjected to uniaxial load and the bending. And similarly, if you see the situation of a multi-story frame, so this is what the multi-story frame, so 2-bay and 3-story I have taken, subjected to the action of sway load, and that sway load is because of the wind effect or it could be due to the earthquake effect. So, when this frame sways, bends in the lateral direction, since it is unbraced, so this is what the bending profile of the various members of the frame. Now, take one particular column, so which was straight, will undergo a sort of bending something like this. So, definitely, so even in this unbraced frame, at the top and bottom, so we have the bending moments of varying nature and magnitude. And we also sometimes need to identify whether the column is bending in single curvature or double curvature depending on the nature of the moments at the top and bottom. So, these are all some of the things that are required for tackling the problems in connection with axial load and uniaxial bending. Now, what exactly this axial load and uniaxial moment is concerned? So, this is what the axial load you are, this is what the load you are applying onto the section, and this is what the moment, combination of PU and MU for the cross section comes into picture. In such situation, so it is treated as a column subjected to the same load, but at an eccentricity E defined by MU by PU. So, from PU and MU, it is possible to identify the eccentricity at which this load Pu is applied onto the cross section. So the eccentricity is nothing but the moment divided by the axial load. So what we do normally in the design, so we assume some section and later we check the adequacy of the section. So this is what is being done normally in the design. So some suitable cross section like say 300 by 500 is assumed, and we then decide as to how much of reinforcement is to be provided for that particular column. And if you are not happy with the size, then the size can be altered later, and the percentage of steel can also be adjusted so that we can satisfy the practical requirements from the point of the required cross section. But how exactly such type of problems are tackled from the point of analysis? So in fact, to tackle this type of problem, first we need to identify what exactly the distribution of the strain over the cross section when this PU and MU are acting. So we use the strain compatibility condition associated with the plane section so that the distribution of the strain over the cross section can be determined, so that we can get the strain profile over the cross section. So once the strain profile is identified, the position of the neutral axis can be identified. So once the position of the neutral axis is identified, it is possible to identify what portion of the cross section is subjected to compression and what are all the forces in the various reinforcements that are provided in the cross section. So in fact, when you identify this strain distribution, so in fact we have two conditions to be identified. So the conditions are, as far as the eccentricity is concerned, so the eccentricity can be 0 or it can go up to infinity. The eccentricity of the applied load 0 means we are actually applying the load through the centroid of the cross section. In other words, the load is passing through the longitudinal centroidal axis of the column. It is a concentrically loaded column. So when you have a concentrically loaded column where you do not have the moment, then the eccentricity is regarded as 0. So this is the first limiting case. The last second limiting case is that when the eccentricity becomes maximum, so that is what is referred to as the infinity. So the load is applied at an infinite distance from the centroid. So the cross section of the column is subjected to pure moment. So there is no axial effect. So corresponding to these two conditions of the eccentricity, E equal to 0 going up to infinity, if you identify the position of the neutral axis is at an infinite distance corresponding to 0 eccentricity. That is, in an axially loaded column where eccentricity is 0, the distribution of the stress and strain over the cross section is uniform. It is a rectangular cross section. So in a rectangular cross section of the distribution of the stress or the strain, so the neutral axis is at an infinite distance. When E becomes infinity, so moment is maximum, so we have reached the critical moment of any cross section. So corresponding to that, the position of the neutral axis is defined, and that is another limiting case. So thus, taking the two limiting case of 0 eccentricity and going to the infinity, or the position of the neutral axis from infinite to finite, the various strain profiles over the cross section can be identified, and hence the position of the neutral axis, and then we can take up the analysis of such type of cross sections for the varying combinations of PU and MU. Now in order to understand how exactly the equations associated with the analysis can be derived, so I have taken the cross section of the column. So you can see the cross section, it is rectangular, the dimension is B by D, the width is B, depth is capital D. And I have identified the two faces of the column. So this is referred to as the compression face. Obviously, this is called as the compression steel. In fact, this is also the compression steel provided the load is axial. As the load becomes eccentric, there is a possibility that at one stage when the eccentricity exceeds beyond certain limit, so this reinforcement provided at the other face acts as a tension steel, and the corresponding face is called as the tension face. But if you are applying the load at a very small eccentricity, then here there is no tension, but this will be subjected to compression. But the magnitude of the compression in this phase is much less than the magnitude of the compression in this phase. Then it is referred to as a highly compressed phase, and this is referred to as least compressed phase. But over all the entire cross section is subjected to compressive forces, compressive stresses and compressive strains comes into picture. Now this is what the column you can make out, there is an axial load and along with that there is a moment. So in other words, so we have PU and MU coming into picture, As I told you, it is something like applying PU at an eccentricity E equal to mu by PU. So, this is what the problem, and this is what the cross section, and this is what the eccentric load at an eccentricity of E from the centroidal axis, creating a moment equal to mu. So, that is what the meaning of this PU mu or PU at E equal to mu by PU. Now, you can see here, this is what the centroid, the axis passing through the centroid is the centroidal axis, and this centroidal axis is the major axis. Now, I am considering the situation of a bending taking place with respect to the major axis. So, the cross section has to bend about this major axis. The major axis is one for which the second moment of area is maximum, or the moment of inertia is going to be maximum. So, in other words, B, small b into capital D cube by 12 is definitely maximum over this xx, rather than over another axis passing through the centroid but parallel to the depth. So, that is called as the minor axis. So, your problem can be either with respect to the major axis or it could be with respect to the minor axis. But for the derivation, let us consider the major axis bending as we can see here. So, this is what the eccentricity, and this is the point where the load is applied. In other words, the load has to be applied on the symmetric axis only, means the bending is uniaxial. So, if you apply the load other than through the major or minor axis, then it will be subjected to biaxial bending. So, that is the reason why I have taken this load at an eccentricity E along the y axis, such that the moment is induced with respect to xx axis, which is the major axis. Now, for the analysis, we need to consider the equilibrium of the internal forces. In fact, we have only two materials as far as the cross section is concerned. One is the concrete and another is the steel, one in the compression phase, another in the least compressed phase or in the tension phase, depending on the magnitude of the moment and depending on the magnitude of the eccentricity. Now, this is what the equation of the internal forces. So, the internal force due to the concrete, that is capital CC, plus the internal force due to the compression steel, and similarly the internal force due to the tension steel. If tension is not there, so this tension steel will be subjected to some amount of compression. So, if you can calculate all these three internal forces, that is nothing but the total load to which that eccentrically loaded column is subjected to. Now, you have to take the moment of all these internal forces about the centroid of the tension steel. So, this is the tension steel. So, we know where exactly the CC is acting. So, for that we need the distribution of the stress also, and you know the position of the compression steel and also the position of the tension steel. So, I am taking the moment about the tension steel. So, the force of the tension steel does not come into picture. So, force in the compression steel and the corresponding distance. So, you can calculate. So, CC means the force in the concrete, that you can get it from the stress block parameters, and the position of the compressive force can also be identified, and the moment can also be taken with respect to the center of the tension steel. Anyway, I am not going to discuss all these things. This is only the procedure or how exactly the formulas that are required in the analysis can be derived. And what about the external force? The external force is PU acting at an eccentricity E with respect to the centroidal axis. Now, I have to take the moment of this PU with respect to the center of tension steel. I need this distance. So, you know this E and this extra distance is to be calculated. So, this extra distance is nothing but, so this distance, that is from the extreme phase in the compression to the center of the tension, that is nothing but small d, which is the effective depth. So, from this effective depth, so if we can subtract this off the depth of the suction, which is d by 2, capital D by 2. So, we are going to get this extra distance. So, this distance plus this E, the eccentricity at which this PU is applied. So, we are going to get the lever arm for this PU with respect to the center of the tension steel. So, that is what I have written here. So, mu is equal to the PU, the external load, into the corresponding lever arm. So, that is what the external moment. So, the external moment because of the external load should be equal to internal moment because of the internal forces. So, these are the internal forces, and the position of the internal forces can be identified, and the corresponding lever arms can also be determined. And equating these two, so it is possible to identify the moment mu and pu associated with a particular cross section, say B by D, for the magnitude of the reinforcement and also for the position of the steel, that can be identified. So this is what we are going to do in the analysis. So in fact, the analysis is slightly complex, and that is the reason why this type of analysis is not included in the syllabus. But however, we need to remember the procedure and finally the various formulas and graphs that can be used for the analysis of such type of columns subjected to axial load and uniaxial bending. So this is what I was referring to. So we have to identify the distribution of the strain across the cross section. So kindly see, I request the students to understand the importance of these strain profiles. So I have taken the maximum strain of 0.0035 in the compression phase. So this is called as a heavily compressed phase, and this is called as least compressed phase or the tension phase. Now this is going to be the tension phase because the cross section is subjected to significant amount of moment, and hence the strain in the this steel called as the tension steel is really tensile in nature. So kindly see here, so this is the compressive strain distributed over the cross section up to the center of the tension steel, and this is what the magnitude of the strain in the tension steel. So this is a significant strain as far as this first line is concerned. So this is what the first blue line, and this is what the maximum strain, and this maximum strain is exceeding the yield strain of the steel. So that is what the strain in the tension steel is greater than the yield strain of the steel, and that is what is referred to as the tension failure. And you can see the second profile, so which is the second line from this side. So the strain corresponding to that strain profile is this much. So here also it is greater than the yield strain, means so the position of the neutral axis will be different, but the tension steel is getting yielded. Now you see this red line, so corresponding to the maximum strain of 0.0035, and if you see this red line and it is touching this particular point, the corresponding strain, if you calculate, it is exactly equal to the yield strain, means the extreme compression is subjected to the maximum strain of the concrete in bending 0.0035, because it is subjected to moment. And if you see the other one, it is also subjected to the strain, but that strain is equal to the yield strain, but in tension. So this phase is in tension, so this phase is in compression. So compression is subjected to a maximum strain of 0.0035. The tension phase is also subjected to the maximum strain, which is the yield strain of that steel. So that type of failure is referred to as the balanced failure. So in a balanced failure, the steel in the compression, that is in the heavily compressed phase, and also the steel, if the concrete in the heavily compressed phase, will be subjected to the maximum strain of 0.0035, and whereas the steel in the tension phase will be subjected to the yield strain. So these two conditions occurs simultaneously. So that is the reason why that is referred to as the balanced condition or the balanced failure. Now if the moment is reduced, then what happens to this strain? Instead of the tension steel subjected to the yield strain, that strain will be less. So you can see here, so there is some amount of strain in the tension steel, much less than the yield strain, means the stress in this tension steel is definitely less than the yield stress, but it is tension in nature. But if you see this last line, so this is what the line corresponding to zero strain at the center of the tension steel, means the tension steel is just subjected to zero stress. So from zero stress, the stress in the tension steel keep on increases, a small increase equal to yield stress, greater than yield stress, significantly greater than yield stress, and accordingly we have the tension failure, balanced failure, and the compression failure. The compression failure corresponding to the situation where the stress in the tension steel is very very small or very little of compressive stress or the strain. So these are the different types of failure associated with this type of stress distribution, where the tension steel is subjected to significant amount of tension. Now if the whole cross section is subjected to compression where the load is axial, or when the eccentricity is very small, then there is a very small stress in this tension steel. In fact, the tension steel is subjected to compression. So, right from maximum compression, so the compression in this steel keep on decreases, but on the other hand, the compressive stress in this particular compression steel keep on increases. So, let us see that type of a combination. So, this is what the situation is. Now, what happens in this situation is, so the strain of 0.0035 here, and here the strain is 0. So, this is what the critical situation. Now, what I am doing is, I am decreasing the eccentricity so that the load at one stage becomes concentrically loaded. Means, the strain at the heavily stressed side will be definitely be greater than 0.002, but it should be less than 0.0035. And similarly, the strain corresponding to the least compressed face, so that is less than 0.002. So, that is what the situation. Suppose if the load is applied through the centroid, it is a concentrically loaded situation. In that case, the strain not only in the compression, but also in the this side tension face will be constant, but it is compression. Whole cross section will be subjected to a maximum tensile strain of 0.002 here to 0.002 here, and for which the position of the neutral axis is infinite. Now, the eccentricity is increased gradually from 0 to certain value. So, as a result of that, so what distribution you have like rectangle, so that becomes something like a trapezoidal, and finally, it becomes a triangular type of distribution over the depth of the cross section. And in doing so, all these lines will move or rotate about this particular point called as the pivot point. In such situation, the stress in the heavily compressed face will be much less than 0.0035, but whereas the stress in this case is greater than 0.002 and it is very close to 0.0035, but here it is less than 0.002. So, all these distributions can be identified using the assumptions which you have identified for the limit state of collapse in compression. I am not going to discuss all these things in all these things here, but I request the students to refer to some of the standard textbooks so that they can appreciate the importance of all these concepts. Now, that is what we have seen in the previous case. Now, for a particular cross section subjected to axial load and moment, so we have different combinations of the axial load and the moment. Now, if you have a particular cross section consisting of some amount of reinforcement, so the load carrying capacity of that particular cross section is maximum. That is what the absolute maximum axial load carrying capacity, and that is what is referred to as PUO or the PU limit, and that corresponds to the point O. I request the students to concentrate on this particular point on the y axis. So, if a cross section is subjected to the load equal to this much, means so the capacity of the cross section is reached with P alone. We really cannot apply any moment. So, this is one extreme situation or the limiting situation where you have applied maximum axial load from this point to this point is a maximum load, but there is no moment. Now, if you see this point 1 dash, so this is the point corresponding to, it has got two ordinates. One is the load ordinate going up to PUO dash, and another is the moment ordinate. So, this is what the amount of moment. So, that is what the minimum moment for which the concept of minimum eccentricity comes into picture. So, that is the reason why this is called as the practical load carrying capacity of the column. This is referred to as the theoretical load carrying capacity of the column, and this is what the corresponding eccentricity line. So, that is the reason why it is called as E equal to E minimum line. But what about this y axis? This y axis is also called as the eccentricity equal to 0 line. Eccentricity is equal to 0 means so all these points depending on the type of the cross section, so the maximum capacity of the column with respect to the axial load can be obtained. And similarly, this is the line corresponding to maximum moment or corresponding to the maximum eccentricity, which is called as the infinite eccentricity for which the position of the neutral axis is defined. Now let us take this point 2 corresponding to this point 2. So we can apply certain amount of load. So definitely the load is much less than PUO, and also it is less than this practical load of PUO dash. And corresponding to the point O, we can apply an enhanced moment on the cross section. Now if you want to apply more moment for a given cross section, then you need to reduce the load, and if you reduce the load, and definitely you can increase the moment. So if you want to come to point 3 from point 2, means we have to decrease the axial load from this point to this point, so that the moment, this moment can be increased to this, means this is what the moment. So in other words, so we have a different combinations of axial load and moment. So what you can do is identify the maximum load carrying capacity PUO for which there is no moment, and the maximum moment carrying capacity, that is number 5, where there is no axial load, and then see the all other possible alternative conditions of axial load and moment, we get infinite points. And all these points if you join, you are going to get a curve called as design interaction curve or PUMU interaction curve, and it is also sometimes referred to as the interaction envelope or the failure envelope, and this is what that envelope is. In fact, we have infinite number of points on this envelope, but I have identified only 6 points called as the salient points. The one corresponding to the theoretical load, the second corresponding to the practical load but little bit of eccentricity, that is what the minimum eccentricity is suggested by the code, and the point 2 is corresponding to slightly higher eccentricity, and this point 3 corresponding to the eccentricity equal to ED, means the eccentricity is equal to the depth of the suction. So we are going away from the centroid by a distance equal to the depth of the suction, and if that is what the order of eccentricity, and the point will be here. And what is this particular point? 4. This is a very important point. This is what the point corresponding to the balanced failure which I explained in the strain distribution. So this is the point corresponding to the highly compressed phase subjected to the maximum strain of 0.0035, the maximum strain permitted for the limit state of collapse in bending, and the steel in the tension side is subjected to the yield stress. So simultaneous yielding of the tension steel and the simultaneous crushing of the concrete in the extreme fiber because of the exceedance of their respective strains comes into picture, and those two things happens simultaneously. So that is the reason why it is called as the compression failure, and this is just one point. The corresponding E, the eccentricity associated with that point, is this line, and this is called as E equal to EB line, and all the points from 1 right up to this point 4, but slightly inside. So they are all the points for which your cross section is subjected to significant amount of compression, and the failure is initiated by the failure of the concrete. So that is the reason why it is called as compression failure. So right from point 1, and if you move along the envelope right up to the balanced point, but not including the balanced point, so we have the situation of a compression failure. But the point 4 is the only point corresponding to the balanced condition, and we have many points from 4 to 5. So you can see a very small portion of the envelope, and your point can lie anywhere between 4 to 5, and corresponding to that the failure is called as the tension failure. So the failure is initiated by the yielding of the steel, and the strain in the concrete will be definitely be less than 0.0035, but as the yielding of the steel continues, the strain in the concrete also reaches its maximum value of 0.0035, and the total failure of the concrete takes place. Whether it is the compression failure or the balanced failure or the tension failure, in all these types of failure the crushing of the concrete has to take place, but which material has just started to yield initially, so which has really initiated the failure is what is important, and accordingly, so we have the compression failure, balanced failure or the tension failure, depending on whether the reinforcement is yielding or not yielding. So this is what is referred to as the PU and MU interaction diagram. So typical PU MU interaction diagram is what I have shown in this slide. Now you can also analyze the problem not based on PU MU interaction equation, PU MU interaction curve. So we can also see as to what happens to this eccentricity right from concentric situation to the maximum moment situation. So the eccentricity keep on increases. In other words, the load carrying capacity of a column of particular cross section and for the defined amount of reinforcement decreases. Now if you plot the variation of the eccentricity alone as the moment increases, this is what the type of curve you are going to get. So this is what the point corresponding to the maximum theoretical axial load carrying capacity for which the eccentricity is 0, means we are at this origin itself. So there is no eccentricity, the capacity PU is maximum. But what happens if you increase the eccentricity? As the eccentricity increases, the load carrying capacity decreases. The second point, if you see here, this is the point corresponding to the minimum eccentricity. So what that minimum eccentricity? The minimum eccentricity of 20 mm or that given by the formula LU by 500 plus D by 30, whichever is maximum. So that is what the minimum eccentricity. So corresponding to that minimum eccentricity, so the load carrying capacity of the column has to be marginally reduced. So in the derivation of the equation we have seen that, so this reduction is approximately about 10%, and that is what the theoretical maximum load carrying capacity. Now if you increase the eccentricity further, that is what the 0.2, if you further increase it, we have the 0.3, and then you have the 0.4 corresponding to the balanced situation, and this eccentricity is what is referred to as the balanced eccentricity corresponding to this point. And if you increase the moment further, and your eccentricity will be maximum, and finally it tends to infinity. So infinite eccentricity means so your neutral axis is defined, but so the maximum moment carrying capacity of the section comes into picture. So this is what the point corresponding to the maximum moment carrying capacity, and this is the point corresponding to the maximum axial load carrying capacity, and this is what the curve that defines the change in the axial load or decrease in the axial load as the eccentricity of the applied load is increased. So this is what the eccentricity, so E starting from 0, it increases something like this. So it can go up to 200, 300, 400, 500, 600 mm depending on the situation and depending on the type of the problem. And this axial load, so maybe for one particular case, if you take the maximum load as something like 2000 kilonewton, so that 2000 kilonewton decreases and finally it becomes 1/4, half, and maybe something like 0 depending on the magnitude of the eccentricity. So these are the three types of failure in connection with the uniaxially loaded column. The first one is the compression failure. So whole of the cross section is subjected to compression, the variation of the stress and strain comes into picture, magnitudes are different, but no portion of the cross section will be in tension. So that is what you need to look at. When the loading eccentricity is less than that corresponding to the balanced failure condition, that is when E, the eccentricity is less than EB, yielding of the longitudinal steel in tension does not take place. This is a very important thing. And the failure occurs at the ultimate limit state by crushing of concrete at the highly compressed edge. So this is what students are expected to remember. The compression reinforcement may or may not yield. So this is really not possible depending on the grade of the steel and its proximity to highly compressed edge. So what you need to appreciate in compression failure is that, so E is less than EB, yielding of the longitudinal steel in tension does not takes place. So this is a very important situation. So the failure start by crushing of concrete in the heavily compressed side. Then what is the tension failure? When the loading eccentricity is greater than that corresponding to the balanced failure condition, that is when E is greater than EB, failure will be initiated by the yielding of the tension steel. So definitely the reinforcement in the tension side has to yield. The outermost longitudinal bars in the tension side of the neutral axis first undergo yielding, and the successive inner rows, if at all we have provided some more reinforcement, so to the inside, they may or may not yield depending on the situation, but the strain in the heavily compressed edge should be equal to 0.0035. So, this is what is referred to as the tension failure. What is this balanced failure? So, in between the tension failure and the balanced compression failure, so we have this balanced failure condition, and this is also called as the critical failure condition. The failure condition refers to the ultimate limit state, where the yielding of the outermost row of the longitudinal steel in the tension side and the attainment of the maximum compressive strain in concrete equal to 0.0035 at the highly compressed edge of the column occurs simultaneously. So, this is what the condition, but this is what the condition you have in the tension failure also. But finally, when both material fails, we have this condition, but the yielding of the reinforcement is the criteria, and once the steel yields further and further, the concrete attains the strain of 0.0035. When steel yields, strain in the concrete is less than 0.0035 in tension failure, but in this balanced failure, the straining of concrete and the steel takes place simultaneously. So, this is where we have to be very careful. So, in other words, both crushing of concrete in the highly compressed edge and yielding of steel in the outermost tension steel occurs simultaneously. So, that is how you need to identify the compression failure, tension failure and the balanced failure, and so many infinite points on your failure envelope that defines either the tension failure or the compression failure. Now, this is what the interaction diagram, PUMU interaction diagram, you can generate depending on the type of the cross section and also depending on how much of reinforcement that has been provided. So, this is what I am explaining so that the students can appreciate the logic behind the development of all these interaction equations, so that they can comfortably use these charts or the curves for the design. So, these things are not included in the syllabus, so not that you should not read. So, as far as the examination is concerned, we need to tackle the problems, that is right, but you have to remember as to what these interaction curves are, how these curves are generated, what is the significance of all these curves and the various points, so that you can comfortably tackle the problem. So, that is the idea with which some of these things are explained, though not completely. Now, this is what the series of interaction diagrams. This is the point corresponding to the axial case. You can see the strain over the cross section is uniform, and this is the heavily compressed or the highly compressed side, and this is the least compressed side, provided whole of the cross section is in compression, but at one stage this may even become tension. And this is what the reinforcement provided, 100 AST by BD in terms of percentage over the cross section, but distributed uniformly at two ends. This is what is referred to as the two phase reinforcement with respect to the major axis of bending. And from this point right up to this point, compression failure range, we have infinite number of points and varying position of the neutral axis and the eccentricity, balanced failure, and of course from balanced failure up to this point along the horizontal axis, we have the tension failure range. So, these are the nature of the strain distribution. So, this is what I showed earlier also, and E equal to 0 means xu is equal to infinity, and E equal to infinity and going up to finite value of x, which is approximately equal to of the effective depth d. And you can also see the inclined line, which is originating from the origin, touching any of the interaction equation. So, any all these interaction equations corresponding to any point on this E means, so that is what the load carrying capacity and the moment carrying capacity, such that eccentricity is constant. So, you can think of many such envelopes depending on the size of the cross section and depending on the amount of reinforcement provided, so that we can identify the constant eccentricity associated with those conditions. So, these are all the various other salient points. At one stage, the interaction envelope, which is something like this, will be confined to a very small envelope only for the y axis, and here as far as the x axis is concerned, So there is not significant portion coming into picture here. So when you take a point on any of this interaction curve, say a point on this curve corresponding to this cursor, means the point is just safe. By chance, if the point is outside the interaction equation, then we call it as unsafe zone, and if the point is inside the interaction curve, then it is called as the safe point. Means the adequacy is satisfied, the column is very safe on the interaction curve, the condition is just safe, and away from the interaction curve, if you have a point for a particular cross section, it means so the section is not sufficient. It is not able to withstand that order of PU and moment, and it is a failure case. So let us see the detailed diagram corresponding to the top and corresponding to the bottom, which I have enlarged. So this is how the bottom portion of the graph looks like. So this is what the top portion of the graph that looks like. All these graphs are generated for two-phase reinforcement. We can also think of four-phase reinforcement. And all these graphs, whatever I am showing here, they are available in PU-MU form. That is why it is called as PU-MU interaction equations. PU-MU interaction equation or PU-MU interaction curves. So these curves are slightly modified, and they are made available in the special publication called SP16. So they are called as PU-MU non-dimensional interaction curves. So why it is called as non-dimensional means, so here we have PU, which has got a dimension of Newton, and MU has a dimension of Newton mm. So if you divide this PU by FCK, Newton per mm square, into BD, the cross-sectional dimension, so the denominator will be in kilonewton. So the top numerator kilonewton and the denominator kilonewton or the Newton goes to dogs, and we have a non-dimensional parameter. Then it is called as PU divided by FCK BD, non-dimensional. Then MU divided by FCK BD square, again it becomes non-dimensional, wherein we will be dividing PU and MU by such a combination of parameters that it becomes non-dimensional. So PU becoming non-dimensional and MU becoming non-dimensional by dividing PU by FCK BD and dividing MU by FCK BD square. And if you draw the graphs, we get the same type of graph. The graphs will be different, but the nature of the graphs will be same. And if you can plot such type of a graph, then it is called as PU-MU non-dimensional interaction curves. These are all the curves that are available in our special publication SP16. In fact, this is what one particular graph I am showing you. We may not be able to see these graphs very clearly, but we have number of such charts available in SP16, and this is called as Design 8-2 IS-456. In fact, we have about 36 different graphs, 8 graphs for 3 different types of steel. So in fact, we have Fe-250 steel, Fe-415 steel, Fe-500 steel. For each of these steel, so we have 4 graphs corresponding to 2-phase and also corresponding to 4-phase arrangement. In fact, we have seen as to what 2-phase is in my previous slide. So here itself we can make out the reinforcement is provided on all the 4 faces. So that is the reason why it is called as 4-phase steel. And where exactly the position of the reinforcement? So we need to identify the effective cover. You can see the effective cover here. So this is what the effective cover. The effective cover can be determined by knowing the nominal cover and adding of the diameter if you have one layer of reinforcement. And what is the ratio of this effective cover to the overall depth, the major depth? That is called as effective cover to depth ratio. So this effective cover to depth ratio has been taken in the range of 0.05 to 0.2 at an increment of 0.05. So that is what I have mentioned here. We can see that 0.05, 0.1, 0.15 and 0.2. So 4 values of this d dash by d for a particular type of steel covering certain range of concrete strength from 15 to 30. In fact, we really cannot make out whether a particular grade of concrete is covered in the interaction curve, but when you take the grade beyond 30, something like 40, 45 or 50, we may not be able to identify any point on the curve. We need to develop those graphs. So that is the reason why covering the possible range of the compressive stress and possible range of these interaction curves are made available in your SP60. So what is important is, so grade from M15 to something like M30 can be handled, and three different types of steel can be handled, 250, 415 and 500, and the graphs are available for rectangular cross section, something like B by D, for two phase arrangement and also for four phase arrangement, and covering D dash by D from 0.05 up to 0.2. So in that sense, so we have totally 36 such graphs available, and students are requested to refer to any of these graphs depending on the situation. And at the end, I will show you, this is what the book students are requested to look into, design aids for reinforced concrete to IS 456 1978, published by Bureau of Indian Standard. So this is what you need to look at. In fact, we have the graphs looking something like this. We can also see the various features of all these non-dimensional interaction curves. So this is how these graphs looks like. And also kindly see the various parameters that are required in defining a particular problem. So I request the students to go through this SP16, appreciate all these 36 graphs, so that some of these graphs we will be referring to in the next class from the point of solving the problems. So this is what is SP16 and the design charts for the analysis and design of column subjected to uniaxial bending. Well students, I will stop at this stage. If you have any questions, so you can ask. So in the next class, we will be discussing the problems. Thank you very much.